Good morning. We're so excited to be together today. We want to wish you a really happy Easter. It's an incredible day to celebrate because Jesus is alive. And so my name is Jamie. This is my husband, Steve. We love being part of the team here at C-Love and also to join together with you in your living rooms right where you are. We have some amazing things planned for this morning. It's going to be a great service together.
Yeah, we're just so excited to be with you, and happy Easter to you and your families. And before we start the service, we just want to open up with a word of prayer. Lord, I thank you that we could just come before you this morning, and regardless of where we're at and what's going on in our lives with all these changing circumstances that seem to change day by day, that we can come into your presence and know that you are the same every single day. And that regardless of that place that we find ourselves, that we can receive peace from you today, that we can receive a restoration from you if we need that today, and that we can be strengthened to know that as we go forward, that you are leading us, that you are holding us, and that we have that hope in this day of knowing that your resurrection took place, and that there is no way that you will leave us or forsake us, but that our hope is completely in you. So we just thank you for this service right now and ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Our kids have something really special prepared for us, so check this out.
You caught us, you're good enough. Pouring out my spirit, reach. backing up here now, pouring out my spirit, receive it all, making all things new, free you from you.
Showing me in this season is the true power of praise and worship in a whole new dimension. And when I choose to enter into that, despite what's going on around me or how I feel, I can receive so much more from the Lord.
God has given me the opportunity to refocus and to have stronger faith due to the fact that I am a single mom and a wife to an inmate. And it does get challenging, and I do get weak. He's actually showing me that he's here during every process of the way.
He has been reminding me that no matter what trials or battles we face, he is right there with us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. Through him, we have the victory. Hallelujah.
I know that it's in these times of impossibility that God moves. God is faithful, and he's called me to declare that.
Hi, my name is Stephanie, and I think the one thing that God has been revealing to me through this season has been just a refocus on him, refocusing on his word and declaring his promises over my life and my family's lives.
Our Lord is teaching me to depend on him day by day. Our Lord is humbling me and having me depend on him day by day. But he's also showing me joyfully just how good we really have things still, despite all of this.
Isaiah 41:13 says, I am the Lord your God. I am holding your right hand. Do not be afraid. I am here to help you.
In the midst of feeling like I'm completely out of control, God is showing me that I just need to be a good steward with what he has given me and let that be well with my soul.
He is the only one who holds tomorrow. I can't change that. All that I need to do is to obey his instruction and trust him. He is in control. And he continues to make all things new.
God has just been increasing my faith, just a new level of faith where I know that he's not giving me the spirit of fear, but love, power, and a sound mind. And that is so comforting that I can just rest in his word and just have faith that everything is in his hands.
Yeah, no shame can stay, no charge remains.
amazing time of worship. I love that it knows no bounds, that as you worship in your home and we're worshiping in our home, it just reaches heaven and it lifts Jesus up and his presence is right with us.
Yeah, and the testimonies, they're so great. Like, I love being able to see what God's doing in difficult times. It takes us to this place like where we can press in, and we do it out of dependence, because when nothing else is holding on, it's like we press into God and then he does these works. And I love hearing that and seeing it, and I feel like it's just an encouragement to all of us to see that.
Yeah, it's really a way that we build each other up, and God has promised that in the midst of everything, he is making all things new. And we're standing in that promise, especially today on Easter Sunday. Another way that you can be a part of it is through your giving. You know, as we make an investment as a church, we're really a giving church, and we believe that it will impact our community and also the nations. So we pray for that, and we also have this opportunity for this message of hope to reach much further and to reach many more people for what God is doing. Yeah. And as we go into the Word, we just pray that it blesses you and that it encourages you right where you are.
Good morning, my friends, on this resurrection morning. Hallelujah. He is risen. I said, he is risen. And I can almost hear you say, he is risen indeed. So you can say that in the house that you're at. You can put that in the comments. He is risen indeed. Because Easter is the celebration of all things new. When he came out of the grave, everything changed. And that's what I want to talk to you for a few moments today about all things new, because Easter is not only the celebration of all things new, but it is the celebration of life over death. Easter is the proof that Jesus is alive. Easter is the reason that we have help for today and we have hope for tomorrow. And church, Easter is the center of our Christian faith. That's what it's all about, because he came out of the grave and he is alive. So I want to declare a couple of things with you this morning. Just declare it with me. I want to declare that there is power in the resurrection. Say it right now. There is power in the resurrection. Why? Because Herod could not kill him. Satan could not stop him. The death could not destroy him, and the grave could not hold him. Having fully satisfied God's perfect justice, he conquered death and he rose from the third day just like he said that he would do. And so this morning, I'm sure there's excitement in your heart. There's excitement in my heart. This message had been stirring in me for a while, and I'm so excited to just declare it with you and speak forth the life that Jesus has put in his word for us to receive. This morning, I want to talk to us about all things new, and we're going to read from John chapter 20. Let's start in verse 1. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. It says, early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. She said, they have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him. In verse 3, it says, Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb. They were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stooped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived, and he went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, and while the cloth had been covered Jesus' head, it was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. Then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For until then, they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. Then it says they went home. So my first few thoughts that I want to share with us this morning is this: feelings, emotions, and questions. Can you imagine the feelings? Can you imagine the emotions? Can you imagine the questions of that moment that must have been racing through their minds and through their hearts. But you know what? We can certainly, I think, rely and depend on and look at and understand what they were dealing with a little bit, because we're dealing with things, all three of those things, in this critical time that we are in. I doubt, though, that we can begin to understand the things that ran through their minds as they went there. They saw with their own eyes the stone rolled away. And in another gospel, because it's in all four gospels about the resurrection, in another gospel it says that the women were going to the tomb with spices. They were going to the tomb to put those on the body of Jesus. And while they were walking to the tomb, they were having a conversation, and they were saying, I wonder, how are we going to roll the stone away? What are we going to do when we get there and the stone is in the way? We have to get to the body of Jesus. And you know what? When they got there, the stone was rolled away, just like Jesus said that he would rise on the third day. The guards were gone. The tomb was empty, and they were in amazement. This was nothing less than the supernatural, divinely ordered power of God that was taking place on that very day, on that very moment. And the greatest miracle of all, and of all times, had just taken place. And church, they did not realize it. Did you hear me? I said they did not realize it. And I wonder what God is doing right now in our lives, in our situation, in our world, in our country, in our cities, that we can't even imagine. I wonder what God is doing. But you see, at first they couldn't believe it. And until you believe what Jesus has said, it is not real to you. Until you believe it, nothing happens. And the miracle of the resurrection will never be yours until you choose to believe it. And once we believe it, then that miracle takes place in our life. According to their natural senses and to their minds, Jesus was dead. And the dead doesn't come back to life. And the claims that he had risen from the dead, they thought that was just the words of man that they had heard going around the community. They thought, these people have gone crazy. These people are in denial. Let's face the facts. I'm sure is what they thought. Let's face the facts. I saw him die. He is dead. End of story. But I want to say this morning, no, no, no. That was not the end of the story. That was the beginning of all things new. Because when he came out of that grave, it changed everything, not only in his life, but in all of our lives. And what is wrong with them thinking, he's dead. End of the story. Let me tell you what's wrong with that. It eliminates the power of the resurrection. It ignores the supernatural power of God to be able to make all things new. It denies the promises of God, and it relies on totally just the natural thinking. You know what I have discovered in life? Things are not always as they appear. Not always. And I believe that they were about to find out that what appeared to be wasn't the way it was. And things are not always the way they appear in your life either. And I trust that on this Easter Sunday morning, that you will open your heart and you will begin to realize that things could be very different than what you see, what you hear, what you feel, or what you imagine. And if we will open our hearts to Jesus and allow him to speak into our lives, if we will allow him to say something that is supernatural to us, I believe this can be one of the greatest days that we've ever experienced. Let's read on a little further. Let's pick it up in verse 19 through 21, and then we'll read 24 through 25. Let's read on. It says, that Sunday evening, that very same day, that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Notice, suddenly. I love it when the Word of God says, suddenly. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. Peace be with you, he said. As he spoke, he showed them the wounds in his hands and in his side. They were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. Again, he said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. And you know what? When Jesus speaks life to every one of us, it's for us and for others. He always wants us to share what He's done for us with other people. And I believe in these days and in these hours and in these times that we are living, people need to hear the power of the resurrection. They need to hear the hope, because so many people are hopeless. Let me talk to you. Let's read on just a little bit further. Verse 24. One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, was not with the others when Jesus came. They told him, "We have seen the Lord." But listen how he replied. He said, "I won't believe it until I see the nail wounds in his hands, put my fingers into them, and place my hand into the wound in his side." Thomas was so determined. This could not be true. This could not be happening. And many times we think that the impossible is never possible. But I want to tell you something, my friends. With Jesus Christ, the Bible says, all things are possible. Say it with me. All things are possible. You know, we know what our Easter Sundays are like, but the first Easter was nothing like what we celebrate. The first Easter was not in their place of worship and singing and praising like we're used to. The first Easter, they were in, listen to me, they were in lockdown in their homes. It was dangerous for them to come out. They were afraid. They wanted to believe that He was risen. It seemed too good to be true. If they left their homes, their lives could be at risk, because they could also identify them with Jesus, and they could die. So they were in lockdown. But alone in their homes, they dared to believe. Did you hear me? They dared to believe that hope was possible. And in your home right now, we are all in lockdown all over this country and in many parts of the world. We are in lockdown. And I want you to dare to believe that hope is possible for our situation, for how you're feeling right now, for what you're going through, that Jesus is ready to move into your life. Because you know what? Eventually, they were able to leave their homes. The fear and danger was gone. And I want to tell you this morning, the day is coming. We're going to be able to leave our homes. We're going to be able to return to life as normal. But I believe it's going to be beyond normal, because I think during these times, we are seeing how much we must rely on Jesus Christ. We can't do this by ourselves. We must rely on Him. And I believe that God is speaking to your heart and to your life, even right now, during this message, to have hope, and to believe that things are possible, that right now, if you look around, they seem impossible. It seems all we hear is bad news. But if you'll tune in to the Spirit of God, I want to tell you something. Good news is for you today. Good news can come into your life right here, right now. Let me share with you a couple of more thoughts. Let me talk to you about doubt, unbelief, and disconnect. What are you talking about, Pastor? Doubt, unbelief, and disconnect. You see, Thomas was one of those guys who expected the worst to happen. I know that you're not like that, but some people are like that. And maybe you are like that. You see the glass half empty instead of half full. Thomas just expected the worst to happen. Let me tell you why. A few days before the crucifixion, Jesus told his disciples that he was going to go to Bethany, because of the illness of Lazarus. And in John chapter 11 and verse 6, here was Thomas's reaction to what Jesus said. He looked at them and said, let us go also. We may die with him. Because Thomas thought if they went to Bethany with all that was going on, nothing good was going to happen. They were going to die. And you and I know, if we've read the Word of God, resurrection took place for Lazarus. He came out of the grave. But Thomas was one of these guys that just seemed to believe the worst. Yet Thomas loved Jesus as much as all the others did. And as we unfold this story and unpack it with you this morning about doubt, unbelief, and disconnect, Thomas is proof that God can take negative thinkers and turn them around. If you seem to be negative at this moment, at this season that we're in, I want to tell you something. If you will lean on Jesus, if you will tap into the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, He will turn your thinking around and you can become positive in your thinking. Why? Because Jesus would be living in your life. Church, when Jesus was betrayed, when He was arrested and He was executed, Thomas was brokenhearted, just like the other disciples. But Thomas could not face the others. His grief was so overwhelming to him. This was why he wasn't there with the other disciples when Jesus appeared to them after the resurrection. I want you to notice something. Thomas suffered alone, away from the others, because of his own choice. And my friends, I encourage you today, I challenge you today, don't isolate yourself during this crisis that we are currently facing. You say, Pastor, how can you say we're in lockdown, we're in our homes? What do you mean, don't isolate ourselves? Let me tell you something. There are many ways that we can stay connected. And let me just give you a few about Calvary's Love. Not only do we have these online services that you are tuned into right now, but we have House of Prayer on Thursday nights. We have Live Free for those that are struggling with addictions. We have Calvary's Love Youth Live. We have Calvary's Love Kids Online. We have adult connect groups that are going to start a little bit later this month. So there's many, many ways that you can stay connected. And I encourage you, please stay connected. Don't isolate yourself. Isolation is not the attitude that a Christian should take. And Thomas found out the hard way. I'll explain that a little bit more. You see, it is a serious mistake to try to go it alone. In times of grief, in times of suffering, and in times of uncertainty, we need each other. Would you tell that person that you're sitting next to right now, I need you. I need you. Maybe you can type in the comments, I need you. We need each other. You know why? Because going life alone is not the way to go. If Thomas had not ran away from his hurts, from his disappointments, and with his pain, he would have been present when Jesus appeared the first time. The very first time, he would have been present. And I wonder, as I thought about that, I wonder how many blessings have we missed the first time around because we chose to run away, and isolate ourselves in our pain, in our disappointments, in our discouragement. But you see, Thomas was still suffering with his sorrow, while his friends, the other disciples, were filled with the joy of seeing Jesus. So let's not withdraw. Let's come forth. Let's not hide. Let's be found by Jesus. Let's open our hearts to Him today and say, Lord, I can't do this alone, and I'm not going to do it alone. Because, my friends, today we make a big mistake when we choose to suffer alone. And I know that some of you are suffering. You've lost your jobs. Maybe you've even lost a family member or someone that you know, a loved one, a friend, to this coronavirus. And I know that you're suffering, and I know that you're hurting. But let me tell you something. Doubt and unbelief causes disconnect. This is the enemy's strategy, to isolate us from Jesus. And if he can isolate us from the Lord, he will eventually isolate us from our Christian friends, which leads us to despondency. It leads us to despair. It leads us to defeat. You see, for many, it's natural. It's a natural reaction to shrink back in the shadows when sorrow and distress comes your way. I understand that. It's sometimes a natural thing. But this is the time that we need to reach out beyond ourselves and connect with someone, not disconnect from those who can speak life into us, those that can encourage us, those that can pray with us, those that can share something that we desperately need to hear today. You see, the power of the resurrection is real, and it's sustaining for all who want it. If we don't want it, it doesn't do anything for us. If we choose to not believe it, then we just remain in ourselves. And I tell you what, if all we have is ourselves, we don't have much. Because every one of us face those challenges. We face those moments. We deal with those situations that are not pleasant. We don't know what to do. You see, there is excitement. There's strength. There's encouragement. There's power in the message of the resurrection. There's power in that. And I'm encouraging you this morning to tap into the greatest source that mankind could ever know, tapping into the power of Jesus Christ. You know, it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation." Listen to this. "Old things have passed." They've passed away. "And behold," it says, "all things have become new." All things new. How do you find that? In a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what causes all things to become new. You see, the disciples, they were ecstatic. They were ecstatic when Jesus appeared in that closed room where they were hiding in fear. And he began to speak to them. And once they were released from there with the strength and the power and the encouragement of the Lord, once they realized that they were safe, once they knew that Jesus had them, the Bible says they were going everywhere, into the neighborhoods, into the countryside. They were turning their world upside down. Why? Because he had brought life into them. They raced around. They told people about the good news. He is risen. They told people, he is alive. And I declare it to you this morning, he is alive. If you know him, say amen right now. He is alive. And if you don't know him, I pray that you will be open this morning as you listen to this message and say, "Lord, if you are real, if you are who this preacher says you are, I want to know you. I want to know you. I want to understand you, God. I want to reach out to you right now. I want you to come into my life." How did Thomas react, though, about the good news? His friends were telling the good news. He is risen. How did Thomas react to that? His thinking was this. They must be dreaming. They must be mad. They must be crazy. He's dead. I saw him die. And the words that he would live to regret were these in verse 25 of John chapter 20, when he said, "I won't believe it." You see, it's a choice. He said, "I won't believe it until I see the nail wounds in his hands, put my fingers into them, and place my hand into the wound in his side." You see, while the blessings were falling on others, while the blessings were pouring into his friends' lives, the negativism was filling the heart and mind of Thomas. The pain was getting greater. And you know, the enemy wants you to stay in the shadows of unbelief and not to enjoy the light of the gospel and the light and the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. In 1 John chapter 1, in 1 John 1, yes, verses 5 through 7, or 5 and 7, I should say, here's what it says. "This is the message we heard from Jesus, and now declare it to you. God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all." Verse 7. "But if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin." My friends, that's the hope that the gospel of Jesus Christ gives us. That's the hope that the resurrection has poured into our lives and is making himself available to you, available to me. And all we have to do is connect with him. Don't linger in the shadows of doubt. Don't linger in the shadows of unbelief and become disconnected. Come into the light of the gospel. You see, it took Thomas 8 days before he would agree to gather with the disciples for a meeting. And to his surprise, on that 8th day, Jesus had already appeared to the others, but on that 8th day, when he finally came out of his isolation and agreed to meet with his friends, on that 8th day, Jesus appeared again just for Thomas. Say it with me, just for Thomas. How long has it been since you were willing to come close into the presence of God, to find help for today and hope for tomorrow? How long have you isolated yourself and removed while others around you have been tremendously blessed? Even in this pandemic that we're living in, even in these some of this isolation that we're in, you see, if you know Jesus, we are connected to Him and we are connected to others. How long has it been since you've refused to come close to Jesus? The power of the resurrection never disappoints anyone. Jesus came a second time just for one person. The others had already seen Him. The others were ecstatic. But you know what? He'll come today just for you. You say He will, Pastor? Yes, because today in this message, He is speaking to you. He is reaching out to you with His love and His heart. Many of us already know Him, but if you don't, He's real. And He's come this morning through this online service to show you how much He loves you. I want you to notice what Jesus said to Thomas in verse 6. It says, 8 days later, the disciples were together again, and this time Thomas was with them. It says, the doors were locked. But suddenly, there it is again, but suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them. Peace be with you, He said. You see, Jesus knows when you are caught up in doubt. He knows when unbelief is filling your heart. He knows when you have become disconnected in your life and in your spirit. He knows when there's no peace in your heart and in your life, and He comes again. And He has come to you this morning because He knows the situation that you are facing and how you're feeling. Jesus always brings peace into a troubled soul. Jesus said to Thomas, He said, Thomas, put your finger here and look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't be faithless any longer, He said to Thomas. He said, believe. And that's what the Lord is saying to you this morning, my friend. Don't be faithless any longer. You have no answers for the situation that we're all in, just like I don't have any answers, but I know the One who has the answer. And He wants you to know Him as well. You see, Thomas reacted when Jesus said that to him. Here was Thomas's reaction, my Lord and my God. He broke down and he began to realize Jesus was there all the time. He just didn't see Him. He just didn't know. He didn't open his heart up earlier for Jesus to show him. Thomas, there's hope for you. I'm not dead, Thomas. I'm alive. That's what the Lord is saying to all of us right now. You know, my friends, it's much easier to doubt than it is to believe. Anyone can be pessimistic. Anyone can choose the easy path. We're not born with faith. It doesn't grow on its own. The Bible says in Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That's what I've done this morning with you. I have spoken forth, not my words, His words. You've heard the Word of God today, and that's how faith comes into your life. That's how Jesus speaks to you, and that's how He speaks to me, through His Word. So I've spoken to you the Word of God. How will you respond to Jesus and His love for you? How will you let Him into your life? Will you let Him into your life? Will you allow Him to forgive you of your mistakes and of your faults and of your sin, the Bible says. Will you allow him this morning to make all things new? He's here today just for you. I'd like you to bow your head with me, and I want to pray. I'm going to pray a simple prayer. I'm going to ask you to just repeat this prayer after me. And if you will do that, it's not that this prayer is magical. No, no. This prayer is just saying what we need to say in order to come to Christ. So what makes this prayer work is that you believe it. So just bow your heads right now and let's pray this prayer together. Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you today just as I am. I'm a sinner and I have sinned. I believe you are the Son of God, and I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I'm sorry for my unbelief. I'm sorry for my sin, and I ask you to come into my life right now. And Lord, I accept your forgiveness. And I know that you are touching my heart and my life, and you're ready to make all things new. Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you for receiving me. Thank you that I know you as my Savior. I believe in the resurrection. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for tuning in to this beautiful Easter morning. We've had a great time worshiping God. I've enjoyed delivering my heart to you, and the Word of God has touched your life right now. And every believer that's listening to me and has been listening to this message, let me tell you something. There's many ways that you can touch the hearts and lives of people. Do it today. Do it this coming week. And watch how God is going to lift us all up and bring us through this time. God bless you, and thank you for being with us.
What an incredible word for our hearts to be encouraged and be built up together in worship and the Word. We're just so thankful for what God is doing in our lives. And if you received Christ into your life today and you prayed that prayer and accepted Jesus as your Savior, we want you to know that we are celebrating with you and that new life has begun in you. This is why we're here, and this is the hope and the message that we want to share. So we would love to know so that we can encourage you in your faith and journey with you in that.
Yeah, we want to also encourage you to stay connected. There's so many ways to do that now through calvaryslove.org, through our YouTube channel. We'd love for you to subscribe to that, and also through social media. And that reaches all the different parts of our church, from the youth to the kids, just to everyone. So we're just happy that we can do that, and we're so thankful that we could celebrate with you today. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter. Have a really blessed week.